Thank you. That concludes topical questions. The next item of business is a statement by John Swinney on legal advice relating to Scottish Information Commissioner decision. The First Minister will take questions at the end of his statement, and so there should be no interventions or interruptions. I call on the First Minister up to 10 minutes, please.
President Officer, as this is the first occasion on which I have addressed Parliament since the death of Alex Salmond, I wish to record my sadness at his passing and express my sympathy to his wife Moira and his family at this time. I will move a motion of condolence in Parliament tomorrow. I am providing this statement to Parliament in response to requests from other parties. On the 3rd of August 2020, acting as Deputy First Minister, I set out the remit for James Hamilton in examining the self-referral of the then First Minister under the Scottish Ministerial Code. I did this as the Minister delegated to sponsor the process, given it would not have been appropriate for the First Minister at that time, who is the usual sponsor of investigations under the Ministerial Code, to be the sponsor for issues relating to allegations against herself. I formally initiated the process. I sponsored the process within government. But in setting out that factual information that Parliament has known about since 2020, I want to make one point crystal clear. The first time I learned of any of the contents of James Hamilton's report was when he sent it to ministers on the 22nd of March 2021. Concerns about the process have been raised in recent days because the Scottish Government has published legal advice on the handling of freedom of information issues, including the handling of a court challenge to an FOI Commission ruling relating to Mr Hamilton's report. The material centred on a decision notice issued by the Scottish Information Commissioner requiring Scottish ministers to disclose legal advice. Specifically, it required us to release legal advice in relation to a previous Court of Session case taken by Scottish ministers against the Scottish Information Commissioner himself. Despite the rather convoluted detail, the key principles at question are straightforward. It has been the long-established position that everyone, including the government, any government, should be able to receive legal advice in confidence under legal professional privilege. In the case of the government, the long-standing position is that it is only in exceptional circumstances that the public interest in maintaining this privilege is outweighed by the public interest in the disclosure of legal advice. The importance of this fundamental legal principle has always been reflected in the FOI legislation passed by this Parliament in 2002 under the Labour Liberal Democrat Scottish Executive. Indeed, as I understand it, exactly the same position is taken by every government in the United Kingdom, both the devolved governments and the United Kingdom government. As a result, it is incredibly rare for legal advice to ever be disclosed. The Commissioner, however, in responding to an appeal from an FOI request, took a different view. His written reasons for his ruling in this case set out an argument that rests on his view of the public interest favouring release and outweighing the public interest in maintaining legal professional privilege. The Commissioner's position was carefully considered by the Scottish Government, and while it would have been possible to appeal, I decided, after consultation with the Lord Advocate, which I am obliged under the Ministerial Code to do, to release the information, and this was published on Saturday. Let me now turn to the substance of the legal advice itself. It shows that when the decision to go to court was made, it was taken on the advice of King's Counsel, and I'm quoting directly from the conclusions here, which said, and I quote, "I consider that there are reasonable prospects of success." In deciding to challenge the Commissioner's decision, the Lord Advocate's view as the most senior legal adviser to ministers was sought. It was equally robust. I'm quoting now from the published minute of her advice, which states, and I quote, "There were three sound arguments and that the Commissioner's decision, and again I quote, should be tested in court." So the legal advice was unambiguous. It supported challenging the Commissioner's decision, and I took that decision. I left the Scottish Government shortly after this point, however, and work continued within Government to prepare for the case. What the material published on Saturday shows is that during that time, the legal advice on the prospects of the case did become less positive. Crucially, however, The advice to ministers of the 30th of May 2023 remains crystal clear and concludes as follows. Our view is that despite the slightly more pessimistic note from Council, the rationale for appealing the decision is unchanged. There remain reasonable arguments to make in support of ministers' position. Indeed, when the case came to court, the court stated in its judgment that the issue was, and again I quote, a sharp issue of statutory interpretation. Ministers were presented with legal advice that supported a court challenge, and the court took the view that the matter was a sharp issue of statutory interpretation. In short, it was a perfectly rational decision by ministers to go to court. So the original accusation that has been made in this case, that ministers acted against legal advice in deciding to challenge in court the original decision of the Freedom of Information Commissioner, has been disproved by the publication of the legal advice at the weekend. That having been the case, concern has now shifted to the arrangements for the Secretariat, who provided support to James Hamilton as he carried out his work. As is normal in circumstances where the government establishes short-term inquiries, this Secretariat was drawn from the civil service. It should be noted that this was known at the time Mr Hamilton began his work. I wish to be clear at this point that the individual chosen to undertake this work was not a special adviser, but a non-political, career civil servant of impeccable record and repute. Despite being known at the time, concerns have now been raised that a civil servant provided the Secretariat function. These stem from comments contained within the material published, where the King's Counsel expresses regret that arrangements had not been put in place to ensure even greater distance between the civil servant performing the Secretariat role and ministers. The KC states, however, it does not appear that there was any briefing about the contents of evidence gathered by Mr Hamilton, the tenor of his investigations, or the potential contents of his report. The KC himself narrates that the Secretariat engaged on such issues as paying for legal advice. As the sponsoring minister, these practical issues rightly came to me for agreement because it was my role to do so. It may help Parliament if I provide some examples of the type of contact between the Secretariat and my office during the life of Mr Hamilton's work. On the 6th of October 2020, the Secretariat informed my office via email of correspondence from the Parliamentary Committee's clerking team to the Secretariat, telling them that Mr Hamilton's written evidence to the committee would be published the next day. This email was duly acknowledged. On the 9th of October 2020, a submission from the Secretariat to myself and the then Lord Advocate was received regarding sourcing and paying for legal advice for the independent adviser's work. I agreed to fund the legal advice. On the 11th of January 2021, the Secretariat sent a letter from James Hamilton to me, advising that Mr Hamilton had received correspondence from MSPs, including Alex Cole Hamilton, concerning his remit. I replied to Mr Hamilton a few days later. On one occasion, I was required to clear parliamentary answers in my name. These were submitted by the Secretariat on the 3rd of November 2020 in a formal submission and set out that Mr Hamilton can investigate any aspects of the ministerial code that arise within his remit. This submission included a draft letter to Mr Hamilton to draw his attention to the answers to the parliamentary questions. Again, I duly answered the parliamentary question and issued the letter. On two occasions, the 7th of December 2020 and the 13th of February 2021, I was either informed of or cleared as appropriate Freedom of Information requests which were to be issued and were submitted to my office by the Secretariat. After Mr Hamilton's report had been received into Government on the 22nd of March 2021, there were emails between my office and the Secretariat arranging a meeting between myself and Mr Hamilton. This took place some days later, and I issued a letter to Mr Hamilton via the Secretariat thanking him for undertaking this work. Presiding Officer, James Hamilton is an independent commissioner of impeccable reputation and integrity. The person who supported him as the Secretariat was a non-political career civil servant. Questioning the independence and integrity of James Hamilton and of a civil servant who cannot publicly defend themselves is unwarranted, unfair and unsupported by the facts. I reiterate what I said at the beginning of this statement. The first I knew of any of the contents of James Hamilton's report was when he delivered his report to us on the 22nd of March 2021. Those are the facts, and nothing in Saturday's publication changes them.
Thank you. The First Minister will now take questions on the issues raised in his statement. I intend to allow around 20 minutes for questions, after which we'll move on to the next item of business. I'd be grateful if members who wish to put a question were to press their request to speak buttons. And I call on Russell Finlay.
Thank you, President Officer. And I begin by apologising to you and colleagues for my lateness. We are here because the SNP have yet again wasted taxpayers' money keeping secrets from the paying public. And even worse than this arrogant disregard for transparency and public money is more evidence of this government's culture of cover-up. Mm. And who's at the heart of it? Again, John Swinney, whose statement today is little more than a masterclass in spin. So here are the facts. A Scottish Government official was transferred to work for James Hamilton while he investigated allegations that Nicola Sturgeon breached the ministerial code. But we only now discover that during this time the official was exchanging information directly with Mr Swinney. She even drafted letters from Mr Swinney to Mr Hamilton, who she was working for, hopelessly and fatally conflicted. The government then spent huge sums of money trying to keep all of this and more secret from the public. And despite his protests today, the First Minister's fingerprints are all over this cover-up. So let me ask, were Mr Swinney's communications with the seconded official done behind the back of Mr Hamilton? Mr Swinney has today admitted some of the contact he had with the seconded official, so will he publish details of all contact? And finally, since all we've heard today is spin, will Mr Swinney agree to a judge-led inquiry to uncover the true extent of his actions? Thank you.
First Minister.
President Officer, Russell Finlay makes a number of points about the transparency of government information. 101 pages of legally sensitive material that, in my view, should be covered by legal professional privilege was published on my watch on Saturday. That's the facts that Mr Finlay skirts past. In relation to the role of the civil servant and the role of Mr Hamilton, I would simply say that Mr Hamilton was in full control as an independent commissioner of this entire process and set out and operated against the remit which I published for him. And all of the issues that Mr Finlay puts to me were all in the public domain at the time of the institution of the inquiry. Can I finally say to Mr Finlay, I have absolutely no intention of commissioning a judge-led inquiry into all of this business for the simple reason that I have disclosed the information that the Commissioner requested of us, 101 pages of legally privileged information that Mr Finlay could look at his leisure if he wished to inform the contribution that he makes to Parliament. But I have absolutely no intention of commissioning a judge-led inquiry.
Jackie Bailey.
The First Minister has form, Presiding Officer. He was the human shield for Nicola Sturgeon during the parliamentary inquiry into the Scottish Government's handling of harassment complaints. He was the one who did everything he could to withhold information from the committee, and he operated a culture of secrecy and spin. And it took a threatened vote of no confidence in this chamber for the committee to see any of that legal advice. And now history repeats itself, and John Swinney is at the centre of this debacle too. More spin and secrecy, but there is now a new low. The suggestion that the civil servant seconded to the James Hamilton inquiry provided information directly or indirectly to the Scottish Government raises huge questions about the independence of the process. And this doubt about independence could now apply to other public inquiries where civil servants are seconded to be the secretariat. Given the need for integrity and good governance, I echo the call for a judge-led inquiry. The First Minister should really agree, unless, of course, he has something to hide.
First Minister.
On the first point that Jackie Bailey raised, the government has just published 101 pages of legally privileged information. Now, if we go back to the parliamentary inquiry...
Let's hear the First Minister.
If we go back to the parliamentary inquiry, the issue that I took some time to be persuaded about, if I can put it as delicately as that, is that I did not want to disclose legally privileged information, because there is a principle about this which Jackie Bailey and I put into statute in 2002, which protects the legal professional privilege of the government. And I wanted to protect that position. And that was the issue, that I made clear I had difficulties with and which I agreed to release reluctantly. But in trying to help the committee in its deliberations, the Lord Advocate of the time went to the committee and briefed the committee, of which Jackie Bailey was a member, about the substance of the legal advice that was put forward. And that advice was given in good candour by the then Lord Advocate. And when the legal advice was published, the legal advice demonstrated that what the Lord Advocate had told the committee was absolutely what was in the legal advice. So why Jackie Bailey has to sully people's character and reputation on an ongoing basis is beyond me. Yesterday, her leader criticised my public reputation. Where is he today? Where is he today to come here and say to my face to face, what he was prepared to say to cameras, and he won't come here to say it to me to my face? I think that's appalling.
I call Rona Mackay. Rona Mackay to be followed by Rachel Hamilton.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can the First Minister reiterate to the Chamber that the publication of the material in this case is highly unusual and does not set any precedent for releasing information that is subject to legal privilege, either legally or within the Scottish Government?
First Minister.
I can confirm that position. The Government, as the Minister for Parliamentary Business said in his answer a moment ago to Mr Kerr, the Government's agreement to the direction from the Freedom of Information Commissioner, which we responded to at the weekend, does not set a precedent about our approach. We maintain our position that legal advice should be the subject of legal professional privilege for the Government in the same way as it is for every other organisation and citizen in the land. It's a fundamental part of our legal system, and in addition to that, it is specifically recognised in the FOI legislation that was passed in 2002 that that should be the case.
Rachel Hamilton to be followed by Audrey Nicholl.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The First Minister has confirmed that he had contact with an unnamed Scottish Government official who was seconded to work for the independent adviser on the ministerial code. But he has failed to reveal what Scottish Government role this anonymous official had when she was on secondment to James Hamilton, who is investigating Nicola Sturgeon's conduct. So can the First Minister confirm whether this unnamed official had any form of contact with Nicola Sturgeon in any of her roles while she was under investigation by James Hamilton? And do you not believe there is an obvious conflict of interest? Because as Deputy First Minister, you were signing off responses
through the chair,
from
please.
The said civil servant which decided the fate of Nicola Sturgeon.
Always through the chair, please. First Minister.
Presiding Officer, I had... The point I've tried to make to Parliament is I had no alternative to interact with the Inquiry Secretariat because I was the sponsoring minister that was responsible for the conduct of the government's participation in that inquiry. It just would simply be an impossibility for the inquiry to operate and to integrate with government if it hadn't in any or communicate with government if it hadn't had a minister who was a ministerial sponsor. Public expenditure could not have been allocated without the agreement of a relevant minister, and that minister, as was openly shared with Parliament, was me at that particular time. So those arrangements are put in place to make sure the inquiry could function, that it could take the necessary decisions that it took, but that its work, and as I've said to Parliament, I had no knowledge of the contents of the proceedings of the inquiry until I saw Mr Hamilton's report on the 22nd of March 2021.
Audrey Nicholl, to be followed by Katie Clark.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The First Minister has stated that he did not see the contents of James Hamilton's report until sent to ministers by Mr Hamilton on the 22nd of March 2021. Can the First Minister clarify that this was also the case for special advisers?
First Minister.
Sir, I can confirm that point, yes.
Call Katie Clark, to be followed by Fulton MacGregor.
As I understand it, the original request from a member of the public was to release all evidence considered by James Hamilton, and the substance of this statement today relates to the legal arguments surrounding that. When will the evidence requested in the original Freedom of Information request all be released?
First Minister.
All of that material has been released, and the Freedom of Information Commissioner has indicated his satisfaction with the response of the government to any request that he has received today on that question. So that has been addressed.
Fulton MacGregor, to be followed by Lorna Slater.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Will the First Minister confirm that the release of legal advice has always been viewed as so exceptional? The first author of the Scottish Ministerial Code, who was Scotland's first Minister, Donald Dewar, made it an explicit breach of the code if any minister did it without the permission of the Lord Advocate.
First Minister.
I'm certain that that provision has always been in the Ministerial Code. It certainly has been in the Ministerial Code throughout my term in office as a minister, and I am certain that there has always been that provision. The Ministerial Code says that the fact and content of opinions or advice given by the law officers, either individually or collectively, must not be disclosed publicly without their authority, and that in taking the step that I took at the weekend, I had to first seek the agreement of the Lord Advocate before I could proceed.
Lorna Slater, to be followed by Colette Stevenson.
I welcome the First Minister coming to the Parliament today to give this statement. My main frustration with this discussion in the Chamber today is that we appear to have completely lost sight of the original issue, which was about creating a process and culture in the Scottish Government which allows people to confidently and confidentially report harassment and bullying in the workplace. It is now 7 years since the Scottish Government instigated a new policy which was intended to hold ministers and former ministers to account when accused of bullying and harassment of staff. However, instead of focusing on improvements in workplace culture and staff well-being and safety, we are still debating the outcomes of inquiries, legal advice and FOI requests. Can I ask the First Minister what steps his government is taking to ensure we finally have a robust procedure in place which ensures people making complaints against ministers and former ministers feel confident in doing so?
First Minister, before you answer, I would say this question is quite wide off the issues raised in the statement. So in responding, I would be grateful if you would focus on those.
Allow me, Presiding Officer, to assure Lorna Slater that the development of procedures to deal with the very issues that she has raised, legitimate issues of substance, has been addressed by the government. There has been subsequent to that a series of updates which I gave to the Finance and Public Administration Committee as Deputy First Minister before I left office to assure the committee that that was happening in practical effect. I think from my recollection that that process was concluded to the satisfaction of the Finance Committee, but if I need to change the record on that point, I will do so in writing to Lorna Slater. But my recollection is that the Finance Committee were satisfied with the progress that had been made to address the substantial points that Lorna Slater puts to me.
Colette Stevenson, to be followed by Willie Rennie.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Will the First Minister clarify if it is the case that in cases like the James Hamilton inquiry, civil servants are not authorised to spend public funds without ministerial authority, and therefore it's essential that the sponsoring minister, which the First Minister was at the time, needs to agree and sign off paying costs, and to not do so would have hamstrung the work of James Hamilton?
First Minister.
That is one of the very practical issues that I had to handle in my role of sponsoring of this inquiry, which was carried out and fully reported to Parliament about the nature of my role at that time.
Call on Willie Rennie.
John Swinney had been a senior minister for 12 years when he took on responsibility for this inquiry, which makes the decision questionable not to ensure that the Secretariat was fully independent, but also seen to be fully independent, especially as he was warned by senior counsel and also the legal department. So at least in hindsight, does the First Minister regret not ensuring that the Secretariat was seen to be fully independent?
First Minister.
President, officer, Mr Rennie has his dates muddled up here, because I was not warned by legal advisers or by civil servants about the arrangements for supporting the inquiry prior to it being established. All of that came after the event, so we are in the area of hindsight. So at the time I was given no advice that indicated we were proceeding in a fashion which was not the normal approach to take. Mr Rennie, however, raises a significant point, which I am mindful of and which I am giving consideration to in my own revisions to the Ministerial Code that I announced in the Programme for Government statement in September, where I want to make sure that ministers are held to the highest standards of probity and that we have the strongest and most robust arrangements in place for handling these matters. So I may reflect on the issues that Mr Rennie raises with me, because I recognise them to be substantial issues that have to be assured and command public confidence on an ongoing basis.
I call Murdo Fraser, to be followed by Keith Brown.
Have all the communications between James Hamilton and Mr Swinney's office now been published?
First Minister.
No, because some of those will have been, I've narrated those contacts to Parliament today. I don't know if they are the entire collection of all of those contacts, but they are all of an operational and practical nature to ensure that the proper conduct of the inquiry could be established on a practical basis.
Keith Brown, to be followed by Liam Kerr.
Well, the First Minister confirmed that without ministerial sign-off by the sponsoring minister, Mr Swinney, as well as costs not being paid, which has been covered by Colette Stevenson, it's also the case that even parliamentary questions would have gone unanswered, because only ministers are able to answer parliamentary questions. And does the First Minister agree with me that to refuse to answer parliamentary questions would have elicited the same howls of protest from the same opposition members now criticising him for doing his job?
Yeah.
First Minister.
I think Mr Brown makes a fair point that the steps... Well, members might make the noises they're making about that, but parliamentary questions can only be answered by a minister. And if a minister receives a question, they have got to be able to answer that, or there will be parliamentary criticism of that minister. So there are roles that have got to be undertaken in good faith. What troubles me about so much of this debate is the constant inference that somehow individuals were not properly exercising their functions, which some of us take deadly seriously.
Liam Kerr, to be followed by Martin Whitfield.
I'm very grateful. A Scottish Government spokesperson is on record saying Scottish ministers took decisions based on appropriate analysis of the legal considerations. This included discussions with the Lord Advocate, who agreed with ministers that the decision should be appealed. Does the First Minister consider it appropriate or consistent with the Lord Advocate's independence that the Lord Advocate helped decide the appeal should go ahead, rather than simply advising that it could?
First Minister.
I think Liam Kerr confuses the role of the Lord Advocate. The Lord Advocate is there to provide legal advice to ministers, and ultimately ministers take the decisions. Now, I am absolutely
Let's hear the First Minister.
I am absolutely crystal clear with Parliament. Indeed, let me just read to Parliament. There's an extract from the minute of the meeting of the 13th of March 2023, paragraph 7. The Deputy First Minister decided that the Commissioner's decision should be appealed to the Court of Session. So I am owning that decision. It was my decision, nobody else's. I took the decision narrated on the 13th of March because I was advised that I had a legal basis for exercising that judgment. And that is a matter of public record.
Martin Whitfield to be followed by Douglas Ross.
Very grateful, Presiding Officer. I think much of the discussion after the statement, for which I thank the First Minister, has raised that tension that exists within the ministerial statement. And I welcome the First Minister's commitment to consider this for the updated code that's due in the near future. Can the First Minister confirm whether actually the process of investigating under the ministerial code will form part of this update? Or will it be a separate document that the Parliament will also have the opportunity to discuss?
First Minister.
Some of those issues will be affected by the decisions taken by the independent commissioners to determine how an inquiry should be proceeded with. And that, given the fact that I have set out in my statement to Parliament in September that I want the commissioners to be able to exercise that judgment independent of ministers, it would feel to me to be inconsistent for ministers to specify the basis upon which commissioners should act. I would want to keep that as open as possible to give commissioners the judgment, but I will reflect further on the point that Mr Whitfield has put to me.
Douglas Ross.
Sir, did the seconded Scottish Government official have any contact with Nicola Sturgeon while the former First Minister was under investigation by James Hamilton?
First Minister.
Not to my knowledge.
Thank you. That concludes the ministerial statement. I'll allow a moment or two for front benches to organise for the next item of business.